Tsagkarogiannis, non-equilibrium processes for current reservoirs.
Okay, thank you very much. I would like to thank the organizers for giving me the opportunity to talk in this very nice meeting. It's very nice to see such excellent places for basic research to be created. So the talk it will be about an old work with Anna De Masi, Enrico Presuti, and Maria Eulalia Vares on the topic of this meeting about non-equilibrium processes. And in particular, we will be interested in presenting a kind of different mechanism for the reservoirs. So this is the plan. I will do like said Cedric yesterday, that I'm going to present somehow the ideas on, from the continuum mechanics point of view, and then I will try to introduce the model, the corresponding model at the microscopic level. So, and then I will show the results and I finish with some discussion. Okay, so this is the picture we see in this meeting. It's about Fourier law. It's we are having a medium, we have our system, which is attached to the to two reservoirs. So far we have seen models of density reservoirs or temperature reservoirs, if you want. So the purpose of these reservoirs is to fix the boundary conditions for my system. And then we would like to study the stationary process that happens in the interior, and maybe have some kind of microscopic derivation of Fourier law or fixed law in the case that we are talking about densities rather than temperatures. Okay, so let's see from a continuum mechanics point of view how we could develop this model. So what are we thinking? We are thinking of having a macroscopic region omega, in which in each point of this region the system has reached local equilibrium. So I guess this is the discussion we had before, no? That each point has reached local equilibrium. So the way to describe this is we are in the space omega, so I can think of some functions which are, let's say, continuous or even L1 functions on this omega. And the fact that the postulate here is that I have reached thermal equilibrium, so there is some kind of free energy density functional at each point. So for each given value of rho at that macroscopic point R, the total free energy of the system is given by integrating this density functional at each point. So the next thing is to put dynamics. So to put dynamics, we would like to consider a continuity equation, namely preserve the density. So we are thinking of conservation of mass, and we introduce the current which whose integral here would make the mass conserve. And in order to put physics into the system, we also need a constitutive relation between for the current with respect to the free energy. And let's say we choose it in such a way that in accordance to the second law of thermodynamics, the free energy decreases. Okay, and a way to write this in one dimension, yes, I should say that we are maybe in one dimension for this talk. This is the way to do it. So I have the gradient of the free energy and I move along this direction. And kappa is going to be a model-dependent coefficient called mobility, and we have seen this in previous talks. Now, the point is that I have to couple this description with boundary conditions, and the boundary conditions will be what the reservoirs are doing for my medium. Okay, so what kind of boundary conditions I'm going to put? I mean, if I were in an equilibrium situation, maybe I would put periodic boundary conditions. But then if I want to model, you know, these two reservoirs that they fix the densities, I should think of Dirichlet or maybe some others. And the purpose of this talk is to motivate some others rather than the Dirichlet boundary conditions. Okay, so just to warm up, let's see what happens with periodic. So with periodic, so I'm writing now omega as being the unit circle, exactly the same setup as before. And now with periodic boundary conditions, the mass is conserved because if I take the time derivative, I'm using the continuity equation, and then, I mean, I'm on the circle, so the boundaries cancel with each other and give zero. And the free energy is monotone. Again, I look at the time evolution of the free energy. I take the derivative of the free energy with respect to time, and I'm using the constitutive law, and again, integration by parts. And if I do integration by parts, I have this quadratic part with a minus, which has a sign. And then because I am again on the periodic boundary conditions, rho at 1 will be rho at minus 1, so the boundary conditions will give 0. So I have dissipation of energy. So energy is monotone, free energy is monotone. Okay. But if I put Dirichlet boundary conditions, this is not going to be the case. So let's think that I have density. Let me say that once again. I'm not in Fourier law, I'm in fixed law situation where my reservoirs are not temperature reservoirs, are particle reservoirs. So I have particles coming in and particles going out. So my order parameter is the density. And I put density at the minus boundary condition, giving a given value, and the same at the right boundary condition. So now the total mass is not conserved, because indeed when I'm going to integrate at the plus 1, I'm going to get a boundary condition, which I call the current at minus 1 minus the current at plus 1. And because, you know, I have here minus gradient of j, so the gradient will cancel with dr, and I will have j minus 1 minus 1 because I have also the minus here. And similarly, the free energy is not monotone because now the boundary conditions will not cancel with each other and will give me these two extra terms, which are exactly the terms I'm getting if I do integration by parts as I had before. Okay, so nothing very complicated so far, essentially integration by parts for these quantities. Okay, but of course, this is not a problem because my system is not only the medium, it is a system with the reservoirs, so I have to take that into account and somehow define the total mass and the total energy, namely the mass of the medium plus the mass of the reservoirs, and similarly for the energy. So I do that, so I define what would be the mass of the reservoirs. So the mass of the reservoirs is essentially what comes in or goes out from the system. So for the left reservoir, I have to integrate all the current that flows out or in, depending on what is its sign, positive or negative. And this would be the mass of the reservoir at time t, and the same for the right reservoir. Okay, so this would be the mass of the system exchanges with the reservoirs at time t, within time t. And I have now to consider the total mass, so this would be the mass of the system plus the mass coming in minus the mass goes out. So now I think x minus to be negative and positive, so that's why I put the negative here, but I mean, I could have also put plus and allow for a sign. And if I take the time derivative, exactly these terms will cancel with the boundary conditions I had before and will give me zero, and exactly this is what we expect. And similarly for the free energy, I have to define the total free energy, which will be the free energy of the inside part of my domain plus the free energy of the left reservoir and the free energy of the right reservoir. And here now comes interesting point from the modeling point of view, namely, how do we understand these density reservoirs? We understand them as being very big, that big, that they can somehow absorb any kind of change of mass with the system. So they are so big that they can provide mass to the system without changing the density at the boundary. So so what happens? So let's see what would be the energy of the left boundary. So it would be a little left, I remind, is the energy density of the system. So if I think that this is constant throughout the whole system, I have to multiply with the volume of the reservoir, and then I have the change of the mass. So I had rho minus 1 initially, and then let's say this is the flux of the mass, this is the total amount of mass that enters into the system. So the mass of the reservoir would change by the initial value minus what entered in the system divided by the whole volume. So, and this is uniform in the whole volume of the reservoir, so I have to multiply with the volume of the left reservoir. So now, under the assumption that lambda, the volume of the reservoir, is very big, I can do some kind of Taylor expansion and then obtain that the free energy of the system after time t is the free energy, not of the system, sorry, of the left reservoir, is the free energy at time zero plus this extra change. Okay, and the same on the right-hand side, where here I have increased, the mass has increased. So with these definitions, if now I think of the total energy as being the energy of the left reservoir plus the energy of the right reservoir at time t, so I substitute these two formulas here, and I go back to my initial formula about the change of the free energy, the change of the free energy now of the total one would be the derivative of both the interior and the boundary conditions, and it's going to be exactly the terms that I was missing before in order to have dissipation of energy throughout the whole system. Okay, so I guess this is clear, no? So before, let me go back. So you remember when I was doing with the Dirichlet boundary conditions, I was taking the free energy and then I was obtaining these two terms from the boundary conditions when I was doing integration by parts. But now if instead of this f I look at the f of the interior plus the left and the right boundary, what I get extra is going to be exactly what will cancel here. Okay, and this is what I was showing before. So I get these two extra terms, and these two extra terms are exactly the ones that they were canceling the ones I had before, so I'm left again with the quadratic part with a minus sign, so the total free energy is indeed dissipating. Okay, so the idea is that, so why am I describing this? I'm describing this in order to see how we are thinking that the left and the right reservoirs are acting to the system in order to maintain the rho minus and rho plus at the boundary condition, in order to maintain constant densities. Okay. So they are acting in this way, they are big enough in order to instantaneously homogenize any change of mass. Okay, so the mechanism is this, that the reservoir can provide the mass without changing its state. Okay, so there has been, I mean, we've seen in this meeting, there are many, many works studying this problem with Dirichlet boundary conditions, in particular the works of Professor Lazinio and others. I will give the references next. And there are other interesting questions also about fluctuations. So one would like to observe a fluctuation out of the stationary profile. And this is a very nice setup where things can be worked out by introducing an action, an extra force that corresponds to this fluctuation. And if I give you a fluctuation, now I can think also that fluctuation being inside plus in the boundary, what happens in the boundary. So I can reverse this problem. Given a fluctuation, I can reverse these equations and find what is the current that would produce that fluctuation. And this corresponds to some power dissipation in the system. And according to this power dissipation in the system, which would be the power produced by this external field, I can study large deviations and functions, non-equilibrium thermodynamic functions that describe these fluctuations. Okay, so this was just a slide to... Yes, please. Yes, this one? Yes. Yes. Yes, but there will be also a chi prime. Yes. Yes. Why not? I mean, I could have different ones. Maybe. Okay. So maybe there is another chi prime here, and this makes different the one that multiplies the external field and the one that multiplies the free energy. Okay. So no, maybe, yes, maybe I forgot to write here an extra one, C of rho or chi of rho, that would make it different. So the important thing here is to see that there is a non-local dependence on the density, namely this J if I go backwards, would be given by the integral from I minus 1 to x of this. So there is a non-local dependence of j with respect to rho. Anyway, so okay, so this is the macroscopic description, and for this Dirichlet boundary conditions, there is a microscopic system that can produce it, and this is well studied. I go very quickly, so in the interior one can have a simple exclusion. So maybe we are already familiar with this generator definition. So but in a picture, what it means is I have particles and they can jump with rate one half to the left and to the right, unless if it is occupied. And in order to impose boundary conditions of Dirichlet type in the boundary, I just need to have birth and death processes with the rate, with such rate that would correspond to the rho plus and rho minus boundary conditions. And exactly, if I impose these rates, this is what I obtain. Okay, so for this kind of system, many things have been studied. We know that the hydrodynamic limit exists. The unique invariant measure can be proved. So essentially, we expect that it will be given by this linear profile, and indeed, the fixed law has been proved. Moreover, as I said, there is a very well studied large deviation theory for both the density and the current in the system. Okay, maybe Gian Iona will discuss in more detail in his pedagogic lectures about this theory. Okay, so the references, some of the references, there is a big story. So I start with these first works here by also Herbert Spohn, who proved these long-range correlations for these non-equilibrium systems. And then there are the works by Derrida and collaborators and Joel Lebovitz, and then this, as I said, work that goes over 15 years now. Okay, so this is about the Dirichlet boundary conditions, and now I would like to introduce this different boundary mechanism. So, and we have given the name of current reservoirs, and we will see what it is. So again, we are in the same setup. We have the continuity equation with the constitutive law. And what was the idea before? The idea before that we had an assumption of big reservoirs maintaining the density at the boundaries. Okay, so what was the idea? The idea was that the reservoirs were providing this mass. But we would like to think of a way that current reservoirs play a more active role than keeping the density fixed. Maybe as they want to provide the current in the system, maybe instead of fixing the density, they could directly provide the current that the system, that we would like to flow within the system. So somehow before we fix the density, and as a result, there is a current. But maybe one would like to observe this current by a reservoir who puts in particles with this current. Okay?
You have a pump.
So it's the pump, yeah. So would be, I mean, yeah, this was a suggestion of, instead of calling them current reservoirs, to put, say, pumps within the system. So, and maybe it's a more active role for the reservoirs. So the current wouldn't be the result of the imposing the boundary conditions, but would be exactly what the current is, what the reservoir is providing to the system. So how would we do that? So we would like to put, instead of putting a boundary condition for rho, we try to put a boundary condition for j directly. So this would mean that there is a mechanism of the boundaries that can provide a boundary condition of on j, which is given by, let's say, a current parameter little j, and there is a mobility which depends on my system. Okay, so there is a mobility lambda minus on the left side and a lambda plus on the right side, exactly in the same way that I have a mobility in the interior of the system, which will depend essentially on the state of the system on the left and the state of the system on the right. So, So this is a suggestion. One, this system now would be well defined. I have boundary conditions for J, and we would like to study whether this system has solutions, what are the stationary solutions, but even more importantly, what would be the microscopic mechanism for the stochastic process that gives rise to these boundary conditions. Okay. So what this says that there is a flux of mass that enters to the system at, from the right, and the flux of mass leaves the system on, from the left. So the difference is that while before we had both birth and death in both boundaries in such a way to fix the density, now we have only flux from the one side and outflow flux from the other side. Okay?
And you are free to choose lambda minus and lambda plus.
This is a modeling thing, and it will depend on what are your dynamics, or you are not free. I mean, you have to see what kind of lambda plus and lambda minus you get. Maybe you would like to get them one, right? So how about if lambda is one? They don't depend, no? So this would be that you have exactly the boundary conditions, Neumann boundary conditions, that impose J, and this is exactly what you get. Okay, so the question is whether we can have a model that gives this or gives that, and okay? All right, okay, so good. So what is the microscopic system? So the microscopic system is, again, in the interior we use diffusion, so we use simple exclusion process. And let's see what is the suggested mechanism for providing this current. So what was the idea? So maybe, let me just... a very small picture. So if I have the system from minus n to n, so let's say n is 1 over epsilon, or epsilon is 1 over n, maybe. And when I had like rho plus and rho minus, and I was observing this slope, no, the current was what, rho plus, I don't have a cell phone, so divided by 2, no? And if I want to see what is the current microscopically, I have also to do. Okay, it's the, I have to divide by n, right? Right? So somehow this is epsilon j. No, this is the microscopic current. How observe the microscopic current. So now we want to put this microscopic current by acting by having this reservoir, so I try to put particles exactly with this current. So this is the idea, no? So if I had Dirichlet boundary conditions, this is the microscopic current divided by 2, maybe, that I observe. So now is I want to define the mechanism that pumps in this current to the system. Okay, so a particle comes in with this rate. But then it might be occupied, so cannot enter. So I try to the next position, and so on. So at the end of the day, I put a particle at the first available position with this current, with this rate epsilon j. Okay? So we hope that this would, in the hydrodynamic limit, give make us observe a current j to the system.
Why do you put an epsilon in front of the
element? This epsilon?
Yeah.
Yeah, this is what I, because microscopically, so macroscopically, the current would be this one, macroscopically, but I'm looking at it microscopically, so I have to divide with, my volume is minus n. So microscopic, if I look at it from the microscopic point of view, it has the epsilon. But then this would be a lot of current, so
okay.
No, it will fill up immediately somehow. But this would be infinite current macroscopically. No, and this is what I want, a finite current macroscopically. So what I see a finite current macroscopically, it's this epsilon j microscopically, and this is the reason. You're not convinced, but okay, we'll discuss it. Okay, so if you believe me, okay, so we will see. Okay, so the point is I put the particles with this rate epsilon j from the right and I remove them from the left with the only difficulty that now, you know, I might not be able to put because since I have simple exclusion, I cannot because there might be already particles. So what is the generator for this process? So the generator for the right, so d plus of eta would say that, you know, I put to the first available. So when eta is zero, this is one. And this means that all the others are occupied, or the others are one, okay? So all other positions are one, so these are okay, and then I have put it in the first one, which is zero. And, you know, I do it at the first available position x from the right. And the same thing from the left. So is empty, there is nothing to remove, empty, nothing to remove, empty, nothing to remove. So the first one, there is a particle, I remove that one with this rate. Okay, so immediately now you see the difficulty with respect to the density reservoirs, which is the following. So let's try to write the equation, not the limiting equation. So I have to take the time derivative. So I take the expected value with respect to the process of the occupation number. And I have two parts. I have the simple exclusion and the boundary generator. So here I can exchange because this is linear. So delta epsilon is the discrete Laplacian. So here I can exchange, but now the question is, I have the expected value of this boundary process, and I would like to exchange. Now I would like to put the expected value on the etas, right, in order to close the equation. So I would like to close the equation to the local density rho epsilon, which is the expected value of eta. Okay, so to do that, so the problem is that d eta, as you remember, it was a product. So I have the expected value of a product, and I want to replace it by the product of an expected value. But this, we need some estimates in order to do it. And okay, there are several methods. I mean,
so f eta is minus f eta is 1. This is entirely.
Yes. Yeah. Exactly. So there are several methods, replacement lemma, I mean, it depends on the models you are working in. But in this case, since it was creating long-range correlations, so we were not able to do it with the standard techniques for hydrodynamic limits. So somehow we needed to do a very careful analysis on the correlation functions. So we look, we take several points in our domain, and we look at the difference between eta and rho, and we take the product over all of them, and we take the expected value. So this is somehow calculating the correlation of these observables, the products of etas, and we would like, in order to replace the expected value of the product by the product of the expected value, to obtain a decay estimate for this V. To say that this V is smaller than something for n large and epsilon small and t for the times we are interested in. Okay, so this was the, let's say, the most technical part, the hard part of this works. And indeed, it's a theorem, so we could do that. So, I mean, I don't want to enter into the details here, but what essentially says is that for the times that we're interested in, so times which are parabolic, scaled in a parabolic sense, indeed, these correlation functions decay. And once you have this, then by use of Chebyshev inequality, you can essentially prove the hydrodynamic limit. Okay, so this is true, you can do it, and then in the limit, you obtain what you expect. So you obtain this equation, so you obtain Laplace equation, heat equation in the interior, and you get these boundary conditions that I have with the blue and the red part. So you see, the point, maybe I forgot, I didn't say that. So when we do this, so when we do this mechanism, we do this mechanism up to a finite number of sites. So if all k sites are full, then the boundary process fails. So I don't put any particles. So, and this is for technical reasons, and the technical reasons are exactly the proof of this theorem. So we could not prove this theorem for k that scales with n. Okay, so this k should appear on the equation, and it appears here, and it appears here, and you can think, no, if k somehow was infinite, so rho is smaller than one, I would obtain only the blue part. Okay, so and would be exactly this. I try to put a current j, and indeed the system gets this current j from the boundary conditions, and the solution of this equation with the, only the blue part of the boundary conditions would be exactly the linear profile with slope j. But now, since our mechanism was failing for, I mean, when I had all k points fixed, filled, I have this also red part of my system, which changes a bit what is the observed profile inside, and I will comment on it later. But at any case, so for k fixed, this is the limiting equation we are obtaining. We obtain diffusion inside, and we obtain these boundary conditions. Okay, so here is the sense in which we obtain it. And okay, so looking at that, is what I was discussing before. In this case, the mobility of my reservoirs are given by these forms. Okay, Cedric, so this is what you were asking. Of course, if I had a way to scale k with n, maybe I would obtain lambda equals 1. But the proof is only for this case. So these are the reservoir mobilities, and for this I can also prove the Fourier law. Namely, if I look at the microscopic current, which is defined exactly by the difference of the occupancy from one side and another side, scaled in the right way, we can see that indeed that the limit of this object is given by the derivative of the continuous profile. Okay, so, but what are the stationary solutions? So now we don't have just J on the boundary condition, but we have also this K. So we were able to prove that as epsilon goes to zero, the limiting profile is the one that corresponds to the unique invariant measure of the system. I mean, we get this unique invariant measure by general theorem, abstract theorems. It's not difficult to prove that. And the question is how it looks like. But this is a simple calculation in one dimension. So essentially, you have to look at the second derivative being zero with these two boundary conditions. For, let's say, a particular case, k equals 1, this is what you get as j effective. So somehow you try to put a current j, but because of the fact that you had this reservoir which would fail at some point, you obtain an effective slope which is a bit smaller, or much smaller. Okay, so this is the stationary solution, and if you want to write it in a mathematical way, you would write it like this. So rho star would be this profile with this effective current, and you would know that the invariant measure is following this rho star. Okay, so just one, maybe a small comment about the proof. We are very much based on the fact that this process, they preserve order. So also, if you look at it also at the corresponding PDE, you have a maximum principle, and the same property holds also for the process. And we are somehow getting this result by having a process that starts with all zero, and a process which starts with all ones, and they go to the same thing. So our process is sandwiched between the two. But okay, so this is for comment about the proof. Okay, so this is the situation. We have k finite. We obtain this stationary profile for this density reservoir, so, which is somehow what we were expecting, that I try to impose the current, but because the system fails to pump in this current at some cases, it gets a slope which is a bit smaller than, or much smaller than the desired one. So more delicate properties we were able to study, namely, so the question is what happens at later times. So if I go beyond the diffusive scaling, so we were also able to prove the spectral gap for this stochastic process. And this is somehow interesting because it is exactly the same as in the case, so it's as in the case without boundary mechanisms. So what is the spectral gap? So the spectral gap would be to see how our our measure of the process goes to the stationary measure. So here is the sine measure. Okay, I mean, I don't want to go to these details, but the important thing is that it goes like e to the minus n to the minus 2. Okay, but this is exactly what happens in the case where I have periodic boundary conditions, so with no current. It was proved by Lu and Yao some time ago that the spectral gap scales in the same way. And indeed, it scales again in the same way also if I have Dirichlet boundary conditions. So in all these three cases, maybe in this case, they don't have this capital N in front, but this is of lower order, doesn't change much things. So it seems that even if I have, you know, this non-equilibrium mechanism on the boundary, the spectral gap doesn't change. And this is kind of interesting, understand why. And okay, so this is the state of the matter in this for this model, and maybe I can summarize. So what did we see? We saw a suggestion of maybe a more active role for the reservoirs, how one could establish this kind of profiles by not fixing the density, but try to pumping in particles with the correct rate. And we were able to prove hydrodynamic limits, find the stationary solutions, study more delicate properties for the process. But unfortunately, we are not able to do the case k going to infinity. And there are some works later on by Enrico Presutti, Anna De Masi, and Pablo Ferrari, where they study the following, which is a similar thing. So I go there over, there is the light. So what one could do is, you know, you have your particles, and you don't have a fixed domain. No, so you have your particles. Okay, so if this is the first occupied, you just put a particle here. Okay, and maybe you have this and you remove that. So somehow the boundary can change, right? So you can always put a particle from the right, and you can always remove a particle from the left just by adding a new one and removing the first available. So this would be some kind of this equation, but with free boundary conditions. Okay? So this would be a case where you somehow obtain this current, but it's quite difficult to write down what is the, you know, the free boundary PD that corresponds to this process. And so they do it with defining appropriately the barriers, so it's a more complicated thing. So this would be somehow avoiding this k to infinity problem. Another thing we cannot do is the large deviations, which would be very much interesting to see, you know, how the system reacts, or how, if I try to impose another current, what would be the penalization from our system. And the reason why we cannot do it is exactly the same, because there we need somehow to replace the local equilibrium that, I mean, I want to replace the process by the macroscopic one, but with an error which is exponentially small, while our errors are only power law, as I showed before. Now the V functions errors are only power law, so for that reason we cannot do the large deviations. And see what would be the corresponding theory with this macroscopic fluctuation theory, and maybe discuss other models or other mechanisms for this kind of thing. For example, in the model that Cedric showed us, what would be the corresponding mechanism to provide heat from the right and remove heat from the left. So it's somehow you put energy to the system and you remove energy. So if there is nothing there, I mean, there is nothing to remove. So it's not clear how to do that. And I think with this, I would thank you for your attention.